Your customer brings their vehicle in with a check engine light concern. You hook up your scan tool and you retrieve system lean or system rich diagnostic trouble codes from the vehicle. So what part or parts do you need to change to correct the problem? Is it even a part that's causing the problem? Hi, I'm Pete Meyer, and this is Cardone ProTech. The Cardone ProTech series is produced in partnership with MotorAge, America's oldest trade publication for the automotive professional. The vehicle's engine control module has only one real function, and that's to keep an eye on emissions. Anytime something occurs in the engine management system that could result in the emissions level exceeding 50% of what the vehicle was already certified to, well, then the ACM needs to turn the check engine light to let the driver know. And when it comes to the tailpipe emissions, the ECM is responsible for keeping the catalytic converter safe and content so it can do its job of cleaning up the exhaust gases. A catalytic converter works best when the feed gases it's being given are maintained in a very narrow lambda range. Now, as a frame of reference, lambda is considered ideal at 1.0, and what that means is that all of the oxygen supplied was able to combine with all of the fuel supplied, with neither left over at the end of the combustion process. Now, the problem is that narrow range is indeed very narrow. It's only 0.995 to 1.005. And you can see that's a challenge to keep it within that very narrow range. But if the ECM doesn't do that, well, the catalytic converter can begin to overheat, and that could cause damage to the converter and, of course, increase emissions. The process at the start is rather simple. The ECM uses information provided by a variety of sensors to determine the amount of air entering the engine. More accurately, it determines the mass or weight of air entering, since that's what the ideal mixture of 14.7 to 1 is actually based on. That is, weight of air to fuel. Once the ECM knows what the weight of the air coming into the engine is, it's a simple matter for it to perform a few simple computations to decide on how much fuel it needs to add to achieve that ideal mixture ratio. Problem is, this only works when all the other players are performing at their best. Normal wear and tear, deposit buildups, even a poorly fitting connection at one of the sensors, these are all examples of things that can throw off the ECM's information and calculations, resulting in a less than ideal air-fuel mixture. And the sensor that helps let the ECM know just how well it's doing is the oxygen sensor. Oxygen sensors can be of the conventional design or a wideband design. And no matter the design of the sensor, its role is the same: to let the ECM know whether the fuel it supplied was too little or too much. And that's an important point to remember. The oxygen sensors, no matter which design, reacts to the amount of oxygen content in the exhaust stream. It cannot physically measure the air-fuel mixture. When the ECM commands an injector open, it looks at the oxygen sensor response to see which direction it goes, too lean or too rich. Using that feedback, it responds by making a slight correction the next time it fires the injector, in an attempt to get the sensor to swing back the other way. You can see this response for yourself on any global OBD2 scan tool by looking at the data parameter, or PID, labeled as short-term fuel trim, or STFT. In some cases, there will be an STFT PID for each bank on the engine, and it's always helpful to look at both. If everything is working as it should, these numbers should be switching between +5 and -5 with some regularity. If you see that happening, the ECM is in good fuel control and is keeping the cat perfectly happy. Sometimes, though, the amount of fuel added by the ECM is nowhere near close to being right. If the oxygen sensor detects the system lean or too much oxygen in the system, or system rich to little oxygen in the system, well, the ECM is going to get that feedback and it's going to continue to make corrections in the same direction until it can finally get that sensor to switch in the opposite direction as I described earlier. The ECM has the ability to learn these corrections and adapt them into its calculations. You'll see it on your scan tool as the long-term fuel trim data PID. As the engine ages and wears, it's not unusual to see that number climb. No matter how high those long-term fuel trim numbers might get, if it's enough to allow the ECM to get short-term fuel trim back where it's supposed to be, that is, switching across zero plus or minus five, well, the ECM is happy and so is the catalytic converter, as I said earlier. In other words, don't worry too much about the long-term fuel trim number if short-term fuel trim is doing what it's supposed to do. Let the ECM worry about it. And believe me, it will if that number gets too high. It's going to use a number that's assigned by the software engineers who design the vehicle, and that's going to vary from manufacturer to manufacturer. But once that limit is hit, the ECM is pretty much admitting that, hey, I just can't get things under control down here. And it's going to turn the check engine light to alert the driver. So what is the best way to diagnose a fuel trim related code? Let's start off by talking about what's not the best way, and that's just jumping in and start changing parts until we have a part that either fixes the problem or the customer goes away in frustration. Never want to change a part until we've proven that that part is indeed defective. And don't rely on silver bullets or those magic fixes you find on Google or YouTube. Even if you have a dependable statistical resource to use, always test your guess before you replace that component. Finally, always verify your repair. You have to remember that the ECM is really your customer because it's going to retest the systems like it always does. And if your repair doesn't satisfy its tests, well, guess what? It's going to turn that check engine light right back on. Instead, start by remembering the fundamentals of engine management. First, the ECM is rarely at fault. The ECM is programmed to take in data from its sensors and then apply that information to its programming to carry out specific actions. In the case of fuel control, it needs to be told how much air by weight is getting into the engine. And then, knowing the flow rate of the injectors, it can calculate how to operate them to deliver the correct quantity of fuel to the engine. And it all starts by understanding what system lean and system rich actually indicate. Now, system lean generally indicates that the fuel air ratio has either too much air or too little fuel, while system rich may indicate that there's too little air or too much fuel. Some potential causes for a system lean condition could be air that's entering the engine but not being accounted for by the engine management sensors. Or the ECM could be turning on the injectors for the correct amount of time, but the fuel pump isn't able to deliver the pressure and volume needed to ensure that the full amount of fuel expected by the ECM is actually being delivered. It could be something as simple as a sensor that's just not reporting accurately, and that throws off the ECM's calculations. As for system-rich conditions, ask yourself, is it possible that some of the injectors are not sealing when they are turned off and they're still adding fuel when they shouldn't be? Or could it be some sort of air restriction that's not being picked up by the sensors? Maybe it's some kind of contamination present in the cylinders, like EGR gases when there shouldn't be, or coolant leaking into the combustion chamber. And don't forget, on flex fuel vehicles, those that can run on either gas or ethanol, does the ECM really know which fuel type is being used? The fuel trims and their trends can help you in getting some diagnostic direction and should be one of the first things you check. Are the ECM's corrections okay in one RPM load range but not okay in another? Or are they just out of whack across the board? If there are two banks to the engine, are they in sync with one another or opposite of each other? Another thing to keep in mind are the four basic pillars of drivability that we've talked about before. Is the engine able to seal the combustion chamber and compress the air-fuel mixture properly? Number two, can the engine breathe? Is the volumetric efficiency where it needs to be? Number three, the ignition system. Can the ignition system deliver a strong spark at the right time all the time? And finally, number four, fuel. When it comes to fuel, it's from the pump all the way to the injector tip. Can the system deliver the right quantity of fuel at the right time and properly atomize the fuel charge? You'll also have to understand how the ECM is making its calculations. Is it a mass airflow-based system, or is it what's called a speed density system, where the primary sensor is a manifold absolute pressure sensor? We'll take a closer look at these two ways of controlling that magic ingredient, fuel, on some future episodes of Cardone ProTech. But until then, I'm Pete Meyer. Thanks for watching.